Hello, hello, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to the Limbag Kamay Contemporary Print Fair. And now we have this afternoon a special talk panel presentation. It's a studio visit with Elmer Borlongan, and he's at the Pasilyo Press in Zambales. This is Angela Silva, your noisy printmaker with all the questions. So let's welcome Elmer to the screen.
Hi, Angela. Good afternoon. So it's a round two of our discussion.
Yes, yes. Salamat gid for coming back for more, huh?
Kasi, my pleasure. It's an honor to be part of Limbang Kamay.
Oh, alam mo naman, dami tayong questions, no? Shop talk. But I'm excited about this studio visit. Kasi it's nice to see yung setup, yung process, and also the ability to even ask questions online, no? Through social media, that we could actually have a studio visit. So I hope, Elmer, that you'll answer my question, no, on the next slide, and that you would introduce yourself to everybody.
Yes. I took up fine arts major in painting at the UP. I've been an exhibit for 3 years now. And I grew up in Mandaluyong, you know, in Manila. But then my wife and I, you know, who's also an artist, decided to move here to Zambales, so we can focus on our art, no? Because you know, there was nothing much to do in the city. We were always in Mega Mall, no? So I think it's better to go in the regions, you know, in the provinces to work with the community. And at the same time, I'm also I've been painting most of the time. But now I'm, as you said, I'm a big fan of printmaking already. I'm a self-taught printmaker like you. No, nag-aral lang ako sa YouTube University.
Tama yun. It's the only way you could do it during the pandemic, no? So over the next few slides, I'll be asking you questions, you know, about exactly that. So if we have the next slide on the screen, remember the big article that came out that really showed how, you know, you learned printmaking through the pandemic. And it was a very good feature article, I thought, because there was also your quote, "I dabbled in prints in the late 90s until early 2000s. But had to stop to concentrate on painting. So it's been at the back of my mind to do printmaking again." So I saw everything
that's correct.
On Instagram. Yeah, yeah. So on Instagram, that's how we became friends.
Yeah, so I started just early 2020, you know, right before the, you know, the COVID-19 happened. But it's also already at the back of my mind. You know, I was reading about printmaking, and some of my favorite works are in prints. And then I've also read somewhere in the biography of Edgar Degas, the French impressionist, he was using this monotype, you know, with pastel or with other mediums. So that was the right time. Angela, you're in mute.
Ayan. I saw your very graphic masks. That was, you know, like very, very visible, you know, on Instagram. So that was good that we were able to follow you during your progress. So my first question. So what originally interested you in making prints, no? And then, of course, how did you learn?
Well, at the in fine arts in UP Diliman, we were just concentrated on painting, sculpture, and conceptual art. But there was a subject in printmaking, but we weren't interested. No, we just saw the big press, no, the prints of the other students, and because I love to read art books, and then I read somewhere, no. From yung mga favorite Filipino artist ko, you can see on the screen, it's Rod Paras Perez and Mario Parial, whom I both know. And Rod Paras Perez medium is a woodcut, but he prefers to call it in the old Greek translation, yung silography.
Kasi I saw that term, silography, you know, in the Philippine studies of printmaking. So I wasn't quite familiar with that. Alam ko lang relief or woodcut, no?
Yeah, and but then, that's also the same term that's used for woodcut. And then so I'm very attracted to Rod Paras Perez's use of the graphic medium. The contrast, and he really promoted the woodcut when he came back from his studies abroad. No, I think he came from the U.S. and then went back to the Philippines to teach. And also, previous slide, yung kay Mario Parial, who's a close friend of mine, he uses rubber cut, so I got a few tips from him. And he was also using yung for his prints, yung pilon. I don't know if you've heard that one. Pilon is like a polyester fabric.
Yes.
It's used for collar and to harden the barot saya. So it's also a good paper, no, to print. And surprisingly, the conditions of my early attempts in relief printmaking are still in good condition.
Question yung pilon, P-E-L-L-O-N, is parang yung, it's a non-woven polyester type fabric for sewing. Alam ko yun for textile sewing, no?
Yes.
And then it will not, kasi it's not paper pulp, it will not degrade like paper wood. Matagal
That's
pa.
Correct. That's correct. So, and I noticed in my framed works, there's no foxing. No? There are no brown spots in the pilon. But there are two kinds. There are soft and the hard. I think it's you can experiment, no, which one you prefer.
Mm-mm. So,
but that's an alternative for, you know, for buying expensive paper.
Well, for all our viewers, I think I've seen that pelon, P-E-L-L-O-N, fabric sold in fabric stores by the yard, no? So 45 width, 50 width, and then thick and thin because of the different sewing needs. And then cut it to size, but I also think it accepts silk screen very well and rubber cut, but I'm not sure about
it. Yeah, I think so, yeah. Because the pilon is such a sturdy material.
Yeah. Di lang ko sure kung pwede for intaglio. Kasi yung intaglio, more pressure and you need to wet it. So I'll test
Correct.
That and I'll, you know. Sige. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You mentioned you have international influences also. No? Next slide.
Okay. When I was a freshman at the UP Diliman, I saw a book of Kath Kollwitz at the basement of the UP library. And then when I first saw her works, no, I was really blown away, and that completely changed my outlook in art. No? I didn't know that it would be this expressive. And most of her works are all in black and white. So these are examples of her woodcut. No? Because Kollwitz is married to a doctor in Berlin, and they live near a slum area. So this is her subjects.
Yeah.
So it's so powerful, you know. I love the black and white, the contrast, and then just the plain black, and then how you can see the process, how she carved the plate. And I was very lucky because I can't remember if the German embassy or Goethe Institute were the ones who organized her retrospective at the Metropolitan Museum of Manila. So
wow, when was that?
Probably in the, I can't remember, late 80s or in the 90s. So I had to go, you know, all the way to the Met to see her show.
Galing. Mm. You also have, this is like so strong, poverty, hunger, and war, and the working class. Very strong themes, no? And
yes.
Associated with expressionism. And you were a social expressionist painter, diba? In the 80s, ikaw? With,
in the late 80s, I was part of the Artista ng Bayan, or ABAY. It's a cause-oriented organization, and our clients were cause-oriented groups.
Mm. Oh, then how about the next influences? Next slide. This is...
Okay, this is a Mexican printmaker and engraver. His name is Jose Guadalupe Posada. These are his series of calaveras or mga skeleton series. He works for the newspapers and advertisement. So it's all current events that were happening in Mexico, no? In the early 19th century. And some of the Mexican muralists were influenced by him, you know, like Jose Guadalupe, Orozco, no? One of the Mexican muralists. He was just a grade school kid, and then he would pass by his shop, no, his engraving shop. And then he would stay in his shop for like 20 to 30 minutes and then, you know, look at the printmaking that Posada was doing before going home to school. So, So Posada is very influential in Mexico.
Nice. Very, very strong political imagery and messages, no? Good.
Yes.
Mexico's got a very strong printmaking history also. You know,
yes, I've been following some contemporary Mexican printmakers as well.
In
Instagram.
and we're gonna come up with something about that, no? Next slide.
Okay, now these are my favorite, Western artists, the German Expressionists. So this one is by Ernst Ludwig Kirchner and Eric Heckel. They're both woodcuts, and they were their group, the Bridge. They had a painters group in Germany, so they were all influenced by Edward Munch, who's also a very influential printmaker, also in wood, the medium of woodcut.
I think I'm seeing a very strong pattern, graphic pattern and influence on you, Elmer. The black and white, high contrast marks. And
that's correct.
We'll see more of that soon, but it's there. The influence on you is obvious, very, very strong.
Yeah. Yes. Even the carving and the cutting, you can notice that they use a lot of, angular forms. Mm-hmm. And then they leave strong blacks in their prints. And this is what I love about printmaking.
Next slide. This is great. Okay. So what type then of printmaking techniques do you favor and why. My question comes from when I was looking at all your works on Instagram, you had tried parang almost everything, no? Monotype to relief to reduction, woodcuts to trace. You know, I mean, if I were to just simply go, you know, left to right, there's that orange and yellow and orange print on the far left. Was that an early work?
Yes, this was also in early 2020. It's a monotype, but it's two layers. I printed the orange background first, I let it dry, and then using the same plexiglass, the same plate, I made another image in black. And then monotype is a subtraction process, no? You wipe the ink off the plate, no? To get the highlights.
So that's the lower right, orange and black one, no? So the yes. background is orange, and you printed that first on the paper. Then you went yes. back to the plate and you covered it all in black, and then you removed it and left the figure behind.
Yes.
And then you printed it. Yeah, yeah, very good, very good. Very good
Thank
for
you.
Me to learn. And then there's, you know, other examples, but I think if most people will go to Instagram, what I really liked was that you described your process, Elmer. So okay that, you know, they go to Instagram and scroll through, they will see how well you described each process, parang, you know, the size and the ink that you used. So it's very helpful. But to answer my question, which one is your favorite printmaking technique and why?
Besides doing monotype, and recently I've also done dry point, I think the medium that is still close to my heart is the relief printing, you know, the rubber cut and the wood cut, because I think this is where I started. So I have also done some reduction woodcut. And it's a difficult process because in just one plate, you carve each color, you know?
Yeah.
So even if several layers, you only use one plate. It's not a multi-block print.
Yeah. I think I've heard that called a suicide print because there's a term for
really?
It.
Suicide. The first time I heard about it.
Oh, because you can't go back, eh? If you ruin it at any point, as you keep carving, you lose the whole sequence unless you can, you know, think of a way to, you know, solve it. But if your intention is only one plate and you keep carving away for every layer, suicide, halaka, you know? So very challenging. But a lot of relief, line of cut and wood cut artists like that challenge. I think even Picasso did one. There's a famous one, but I forget. But he's done that, see Picasso. So
yeah, he's done it with lino cuts.
Yes, yes. If everybody will go, I think, and Google, there's a bowl of fruits. And he might have done that. And they show it in a museum, the various proofs of cutting it back. So the rubber cuts and wood cut, you said that you love the graphic quality and the art of carving, no?
Yes.
And I picked this up, huh, from Instagram. The act of carving the plate relates to the hard labor of workers and peasants. And you love the idea of multiples, and each hand-pulled print is considered an original. So we're going to play our first video, and this is relief printing. Basic relief printing, but with a spoon. So let's watch the video. Mm-hmm. Wow. Wow, how cute.
Thank you very much. I never get tired of watching this type of process video, especially when you print reveal. I would like to mention two things about this video. No, one, it's a mini print, and the plate that I use, not the rubber, is just a retazo. No, because when I do print, no, a plate, a rubber cut, usually that it has a parang shape. No, it's called a jigsaw. I cut the image and then I remove the excess. So yung mga retazo, the pieces of rubber, I just keep them in my drawer. And then one time, no, parang I was looking for an inspiration. So I just grab one retazo of the rubber and then stare at it, and then I imagine a figure, like a figure in the pose of a manager. So this is how I came about it. And then you will also notice that I'm using, this is printing without a press. So this is hand burnished. You notice I'm using two types of tool, to press the paper. That one is a bamboo baron. No? It's, oh. Show and tell. Show and tell, oh. Printmaking tools.
So cute, yung maliit na bamboo baron mo. I've only seen them bigger. But where did you get them?
This is the actual size, of the baron. Parang palm size. Uh-huh. You hold it like that. This is used for yung mga wood block print, yung ukiyo-e in Japan. Yung maliit na horn baron, the bamboo baron, I bought it in Facebook Marketplace. It came with a wood carving tool. Like, 5 pieces carving tools. And then it came with a small, cute baron.
Ang cute! It's perfect for small prints, no? So that you can be very detailed in your rubbing,
Yes.
No? So this is lots of tips from you. Let's go on to the next slide because I think I have another question. Going back, what do you like about printmaking versus other media and processes? So we're going to come up with a video, but you can see on the left, can you describe what you have? And then on the right, there's this etching press.
Here you can see the actual print, the artist proof. And then on the right is the plate, not the rubber. It's also called the matrix. You'll notice that the image is reversed. So for printmakers, you also always have to remember that when you put an image on the plate, it always has to be reversed. So when you print it, the negative becomes the positive. So that's how you do it. Now, before, when I went back to printmaking last year, all my prints were hand burnished. Kasi that's how I started in the 90s. So I used wooden spoon, tapos yung all types of baron, I was able to use this bamboo baron I bought in Tokyo. And then the types of baron that you can also use, this one is a speedball. It has a foam and the screen, and then it has a wooden handle. So you can also use this. And then also the glass baron from Print Frog. This one, I asked a friend to order this for me in the States. So it's a solid glass, so it's quite heavy. So you don't need to put a lot of pressure, you know, on the paper. But then I noticed, no, masyado nang masakit yung braso ko sa kakaprint, so I can only manage to do an edition of like at the most 10 editions. So I asked some of my local printmaker friends, like Benji Torado Cabrera, if you know someone selling an etching press, kasi dito sa atin sa Philippines, there's no available press that you can buy, you know, unless it's custom-made or fabricated. So, sabi niya, si yung painter and printmaker, si Sir Raul Isidro, is, you know, you call him up or send a message, and then he has a press. So, eto meron siya, yung pinakita niya sa akin, at ano na sa kanya, 10 years na sa kanya itong etching press. The bed size is 13 inches by 24. Tapos it's a gear drive, and then merong tatlong handle, no? So para smooth yung pag-press. And then also, it's a tradition na when you buy your own press, you give it a name. So, sige, sabi ko, sige, mag-isip ako ng name, and then I named my etching press Pinpin. It's named after Pinpin. Yeah, P-I-N-P-I-N. It's named after Tomas Pinpin, the first Filipino printer during the Spanish time.
Yeah, it's right there on the brass plate on the side of the bed, oh, Pinpin. You know?
Yes. Yeah.
And I've also named my presses Berkeley and Barcelona and one more. You know, depending
it's cute,
on where I got my presses.
It's all city. Mm-mm. City names.
Oh, Berkeley, and then isa pa. So yes, I also have a collection, but we'll be looking at your interesting alternative presses. You know, in our
and then one more, the white thing on the bed, that's a felt blanket.
No, importante.
You have to importante yan, to protect the drum in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Tama. Mm-hmm. Next slide. Let's go to the next. Dami pa. So remember when I talked about this? That what do you like about printmaking? Parang this is the exciting part I think most printmakers, you know, really enjoy. And let's just look at the video and let's talk about it as soon as it's over. What is it?
It's the heavy metal ox. It's a rubber cut print. That's what you call the print reveal.
Yes, you know? Exactly. Parang you don't know what you're gonna get until you really open it and hold it up, and then you put it down and you study it. Is it good?
Yes.
Is it clear? Is it crisp? But still, it's one, to me also, the most exciting part, tawag natin the reveal, no? Oh.
Yes, that's always the most exciting part. And, you know, even if I make like 100 or 1,000 editions, you know, I always get the same feeling, no?
Yeah.
Yung anticipation, did I get the right inking? Did I... you know, adjust the right pressure. So maganda kasi in the previous slide you saw the plate and the pre-artist proof, and then this one yung video naman, and then I printed it with the etching press, no?
Yes,
it was
yes.
Print by Pinpin.
Yes. So next slide, next question. Ayan, this is the let's go back in again into the final print. And you used Awagami Okawara. It's a thin paper, no?
Yes, Awagami is a brand of Japanese washi paper, no? It's made in Japan in a city in Tokushima. So I just discovered it from, just reading and then looking at Instagram, and then so I was curious to use it because most printmakers are using this type of paper. So it's a good thing that this paper is already available locally. So if you want to know where I bought it, I can send you a message or email, and then I'll send you the link, no? And this type of washi paper are non-acidic.
So they last longer. What's going to happen, Elmer, is all the tips that you might want to share with us. No, we're going to have a kind of a resources page that viewers and printmakers can download so that they could share tips with each other or learn something, So it's going to be a resources download. We'll be announcing that very soon before the fair ends. Next slide. Let's look at the next slide. I think it's my next question. So where did you learn, because I saw on Instagram that you were starting to use alternative presses, and you said that you were using a tortilla press, and you got it from an online Instagram source, Tres Gatos Press. What's that about?
Tres Gatos Press is a printmaking duo in Guadalajara, Mexico. So I've been following their Instagram, and then I was curious that because they were using tortilla presses, for their prints. So that's I was curious, and this is also what I love about printmaking is are the presses, the tools. I love their mechanism. So I studied their construction. I watched some videos on how to make tortilla presses. So I asked my friend who's a furniture maker and restorer of wood to make one for me, but I still have to tweak the design, and I can print a 9 by 12
Nine
plate.
by two. For some viewers might not be familiar, yung tortilla press is it presses down and makes a ball, yung dough, very, very flat and round, parang lumpia wrapper, no? And that's for the corn tortillas for the Mexican cuisine, no? So yun ang tortilla press. So next slide. Ayan. You did this for Print Day in May this year when I had started a group and said, well, my friends, do you want to do something on the first international Saturday, first Saturday in May? It's an international event, Print Day in May, that you spend the day making prints, and then here what we did was we shared it in the evening with a Zoom group show. And you made cuento that you actually did this of an owl mask based on Robert Alejandro's design for Papel Melrotti. And this is what's the Tagalog word for owl?
Quago.
Quago. Okay. So you printed this. So how big is this, Elmer? Yung kamay mo for hand in your tortilla press.
So the width is probably 6 inches.
Next
Yeah, so
slide.
it's currently six by six.
So this is a finished print.
That's correct.
Very.
And then I printed this one for your information using the tortilla press.
That's why I picked it off for the press. And then what's the one on the right?
The one on the right, I used gold metallic ink. It's
Ganda,
also for
ganda.
relief printing, and then on black paper. But it was
Ganda.
very challenging because it's so different with printing on white paper. No, you really have to adjust the pressure when you print like white or light colored inks or metallic inks on colored papers.
Yeah, yeah. That's going to be very challenging, no? It's nice to try it because iba naman yung reflection ng metal. Next slide. Let's look on. Dami pa. Oh, this is the video on the tortilla press. And I think I would like to challenge people to listen to the music, huh? This has music in the background because you like to work and paint and make prints to music, no?
Yes.
So let's play the video.
Yeah.
Sabi ni Mr. Sena, naka-achieve ko raw lahat ng texture.
Elmer, nervous ako every time.
Nervous ako.
Rotating it. Nervous ako.
So diba? you're not alone kasi minsan pagka when I post this type of video sa print reveal, most of the comments are like that, parang they were so nervous parang the print will turn out good, no? And yeah, and it was successful, and it's also four times you have to rotate it. Tapos yung for this type of print, I use an oil-based ink. And then dun sa paper, it's already cut. It's an Italian paper, the Montval, and it's 300 grams. So I had to damp the paper.
Ah, kaya pala first. Parang I was not because usually you kind of do not know for relief, pwede lang manipis and very smooth paper. But I can understand why makapal yung 300 GSM, di ba? So
yes,
to soften it a bit and to accept the oil ink very evenly, I think it makes sense how to dampen it, no? Sige. So the next...
Yes.
Let's go on to the next one.
Have a drink muna.
Ayan, no? Ikaw. Where's your glass of your toast?
Cheers.
Thank you. Now, this one was kind of exciting because you had said that you wanted to share some good news about the Open Press project, no? And there's a link there that people can go to look for it, Open Press Project. But can you tell us a story about this?
Yeah. I learned the Open Press Project also from Instagram. So I followed their page. And then the Open Press Project was founded by two designers in Cologne, Germany. They're very young, like in their mid late 20s. So Martin Schneider and Dominic Smits, they were thinking because it's so hard to produce an intaglio print because the presses are expensive, and it's also very heavy because of the metal that we use. So they came up with a very small 3D printed press. So they distributed the free plans in 2018, and then they sent it to some printmakers to test it. And this type of print, if you have an access to a 3D printer, you can make your own press. No, you can just go to their link, no, and then download the link to make a tiny press. But for me here in Zambales, I don't know anyone who's doing this 3D printing. So I went to their website. No, I wrote them, and then I asked them if they can ship door to door to the Philippines, and they replied, and then they said, "Yeah, we can do that." So I was so excited. So I did the order. I made the payment online, and then I waited. So luckily, after a few weeks, no, it arrived in San Antonio, Zambales, no, directly to my studio. So immediately, I tried it, no, to do small prints and the dry points on Tetra Pak, which we will also discuss.
Yeah, how small is small? Mga 3x5, no? Yung paper?
Yes. For this one, if you want margin on the paper, for this owl print, no, I did another owl print, it's 2x3.
Wow, ang liit, no? But
yeah, maliit.
It's doable. So I think next slide. This is a video that you did, you made with printing a Tetra Pak. What is a Tetra Pak na? Yung juice pack.
Yes, these are milk cartons, no, that you buy from the grocery. Yung it contains milk, juice, no, and then this is an example, no. So this is ano na to, empty.
Uh-uh. So what happens? Then, what happens? You cut it up?
Yeah. First, you clean the inside, no, with running water, and then you open it up, and then press it, and then remove the plastic cover, and then when you pressed it, you use a box knife or a cutter, and then you cut both ends, and then you will notice at the back there's a like a connected part. You cut that up in the middle, and then you'll have this.
So
flat
you have
lid.
And you carve on the metal
on the inside
side.
On the middle. Yeah, because inside to protect the contents, not to protect the liquid, it's lined with a thin aluminum.
Ah, good.
But yeah, but the front is actually a cardboard, no?
Yeah.
Carton.
Good.
So you can use any other. I'm not advertising this milk, so you can use other kinds of, as long as it's Tetra Pak, no? So you can use even the small juices.
Yeah.
So
let's
this
take a
is
look
the
at-
example.
Yeah, let's take a look at the video.
Thank you.
I was also getting nervous. You know?
Right.
Ang liit, no? So I hope when people want to ask questions about it, no, how small it is, I just also wanted to share how you got that directly from Open Press, no? I want to show how a locally manufactured 3D etching press is, because I got mine from a 3D printer, you know, in Bacolod, no? So, no? And then, ayan, so you can also...
it's red, cute.
Oh, no? So you can have it in different colors, no? Depending on your fabricator, 3D printer. Because the files are free, no? They want to support and spread printmaking love. But just quickly, lang, one more. The same machine, alternative machine, you can actually get online through Shopee or Lazada, what they call die-cut embossing machines that will also have rollers and that will also press. So what I found, about the same price as having a 3D printed press, is itong maliit na embossing machine with a handle. So you open it up, no? And then it becomes like a little press. And you can actually also, you know, run a plate through it. It's got metal rollers, so it's quite firm pressure. You just have to build it up, you know, the way that you did. So, pwede rin to, you know, just for learning.
Ang ganda.
Playing.
Oo.
Shopee, Lazada, China. Nako, China. Okay? So, let's go on to the next slide.
It's maganda, another... no? It, Angela, that's portable and you can also use it for workshops.
Yeah. But, nako, I don't know if I can show it to you, but... I do have one, and I don't know if I've shown it to you yet, but I hope viewers will understand that when we start talking like this among printmakers, we want to share tools, we want to show off, you know, the things that we have so that it could be, you know, helpful to other people who don't have maybe all the tools or techniques yet, but they want to try. So I am just going to quickly grab, I don't know if we can. Are you interested? I can show it to you next time.
Yes, of course. No, I'd like to see it.
Oh, okay. So maybe I'm going to take a. I'm going to grab it so they can go widescreen so I can explain it to you.
Siguro, while waiting for you, I can also like mention where I got the colored press that I used for the demo.
Yes. So if we can do a backslide, back one slide. Sige, I'll be right back.
Okay. So the Open Press project 3D printed tiny press that I use was donated by the guys from Cologne, Germany, because I wrote them and then I mentioned Limbag Kamay to them. So they were very kind to send me another printing press, you know, and some materials like ink and paper to use for this demo. So probably after the print fair, we can do also workshops here in Zambales to make intaglio prints.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think I'm back, and mamaya na yung headset ko. If this is a little heavier, no? But Elmer,
there's a bigger version.
Yes, it's a die-cut embossing machine, no? Called the X-Cut Express, no?
Mm.
And then, may handle, yung mabigat medyo, no? So I'm gonna try my best. But this is what happens. I'm going to go down. Ayan. So I am opening it up, no? And then it becomes a bed that I can feed through. I hope, you know, you can see it. So demo. Then, ayan, no? And then the handle is here. So this is like A4, parang 8.75 by 30 inches, whatever, however long bed you want. You just make it up. But it has, what's nice about it is that it has pressure control. So you can make it tighter for intaglio, or you can make it less tight for relief. No? Yeah.
Okay. Angela, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Is that the one, the knob on top?
Yes.
That's for the pressure?
Yes. It can lower the rollers and it can raise it up. So ang problem, this one is very popular in the US and UK, Europe, but the manufacturer, made in China, but European manufacturer, kind of like has discontinued sales, very hard to find. But there are, and I have found, substitutions. So, you know, I can give you a list of names and brands. And this was on Shopee, not this exact one, but on Shopee and Lazada. And they run around, you know, 10,000. So that is an investment, but it will give you enough pressure to make A4 size prints. So, ganon. I can, you know, we can just share more of that in our resource page. So let's go back to our
and Angela, the bed that you use is just a plywood. So you just made your own.
Yes,
it didn't come with a die cut press.
Meron no, kasama yung parang plexiglass and metal because it's for cutting die cut yung parang cutouts no.
Mm.
So it has to be very strong, but. It's very short for us printmakers. So you just find a substitution board, ito, no? Parang yung mga chopping board sa kusina, chopping board, you know, up to half an, ano to? 1/4, 1/2 inch. And then that's it, as long as you want. So you can make a long print, you know, horizontally. So I can send you more links to that brand substitutions. Hindi itong X-Cut Express, meron mga iba, no? And it is available. So it's an option if we cannot get to our etching press fundraiser that we are trying. We are raising funds with Print Fair that we will build presses like what you have, like what I have, so that more printmakers can make medyo bigger prints, 12 by 20. That's the small desktop size. So, let's go back to our show.
Yeah.
Medyo,
Angela, I think there's a question regarding the press, but we can answer that during the Q&A.
Okay. I got a prompt. I gotta put this back. Can you hear me now, everybody?
Yeah. Yes, it's clear. We can hear you.
This press substitutions will run around 8.5 to 10. I bought mine from Manila when they were somebody had stock, and then ran out because I bought several and I told some friends to buy some, so. Wala na sa Manila so far. And that was around 8.5 plus shipping to Negros. The other brands are running around that amount, no? Mm. So it's not bad for an intermediate press until the etching press, yung prototype namin ng association, ng AP, ng Limbag Kamay, ng Fundacion, we are all trying to build the proper etching presses. So, ganon, no? We don't have to, if you can't afford it, then you can do in between until you can save up for the proper press. Okay? So, let's go
thank
back.
You, Angela. The Open Press Project, Tiny Press, if someone would like to know, That one, you know, if you ordered it, would cost you $70. But you know, including shipping, it's not dollar, sorry, it's euro. So including shipping, it was 78 euro. So probably it, I paid in pesos, mga 5,000.
Yes.
And
if I may, there's still feedback. Sorry.
Angela, there's no sound.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yes. That's clear.
Sorry. Plugged in. The local press I had made from a fabricator in Bacolod was about 3K. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But my problem, Elmer, is that the plastic top roller, you would really need to learn to use it so that you can adjust the pressure. What we have also, I also have one, is metal. The metal one has more consistent pressure. So let's move on to the next slide. The next question, have you tried other printmaking techniques? Because you started to talk about kitchen lithography. So what is kitchen lithography, Elmer?
To give a short background, lithography is based on the fact that grease and water doesn't mix, no? They repel each other. So for this technique, it's called planographic, or so it's a plane surface, and then you make the design on a flat surface. But normally for lithography, you use a big stone, no, a limestone, very thick and heavy. So it's very difficult, no, to attain all those materials, no? And also you will also use a special printing press for lithography. And then, you know, at the same time, I came upon it on Instagram, no? The kitchen lithography was invented by a French artist, Emily Isaire, in 2011. So she promoted it online. And then you can just use the basic materials from your kitchen. Like for the surface, you use an aluminum foil, a Coca-Cola, an alternative for the acid, and vegetable oil. Of course, you need to use a lot of water, some sponge, an ink, and a roller.
Yes. You actually did an instructional demo for your wife, Plet. And you taught her how to make a kitchen litho. I've tried it. I failed, huh? But still, you did it. So this is good. Let's watch the video.
then we're just gonna pour the Coke on top of it. Any which way, Master?
Any which way. Just make sure you cover all the lines with the soda, with the cola.
Pick it up.
Yes. And drip the cola. And wash it off.
I don't pour it.
Yep.
Sure?
Yeah.
Ooh, waterfalls. It can't.
No, and then
I have to dampen it.
Plate damp.
Like, can I do it like this or?
Yeah, the whole thing. You can cover the whole thing. Remove the paper towel.
So do I press it?
Yeah, press it a little bit. Yeah. The next is we're going to wipe the plate with
Vegetable
oil. You can pour
on top.
Yeah, a little bit. Some more. Okay, that's it.
And just spread it.
And then wipe it. Wipe the whole thing.
So what if the lines are getting erased?
That's fine. That's the magic of it.
Magical Sunday morning.
And then when you wipe the, when you remove the pastel, you will notice there's a ghost image of the
I drawing. Have to wipe it off all this.
Yeah, you have to wipe it off.
Ah, wipe it off.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Then you will notice there's a ghost, there's already a ghost image.
Ooh, spooky.
So that's what happened, no? When you sensitize the drawing using the cola. There's now the ghost image.
My self-portrait.
On the foil. After you alternate it with a clean sponge with water and then the ink. This is the etching in Charbonnel. We have an audience.
Huh? Welcome. Ooh, they flew away. They're conscious. Voila. And now I turn it over to the master to do the printing. Thank you.
With the sponge, it always has to be wet. The plate. Wet the plate. And then wipe with water. And then alternate with ink.
Wow.
That's it.
I need to take a lesson from you. Parang I think lithography is kind of like one of the most difficult, but
it's so
I agree.
Chemistry.
Yeah, it's very scientific. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very the process is complicated, you know. And mm-hmm. don't worry, because during my first attempts, I also failed, you know. Because you really have to study the medium and then see how the oil and the soda reacts, you know.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
In Coca-Cola, if you look at the ingredients, there's a mild acid content. Mm-hmm. It's called phosphoric acid.
Yes, phosphoric acid. Imagine that. It etches, you know, on the metal foil. Imagine what it does to our teeth. Imagine what it does to our stomach, you know.
That's right. You're drinking too much acid.
Oh, ay nako. So
and then I would also take note that you know, for this type of printmaking process, the kitchen lithography, you can also print it without a press.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You can use hand burnished. You when you put the paper on top of the plate, before you burnish it, you put a plastic sheet on top. So
what
when
does that
you
do?
To protect the paper, because the paper is damp.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, para ma hindi siya maano, so you won't scratch the paper.
Yeah.
So you're just going to rub on top of the plastic to press the image.
There are this French printmaker, see Emily, I forget her last name, who started
yes.
the kitchen litho. She has books on it, workshops, and a lot of people have downloaded instructions. So it's something you can actually try in your kitchen with aluminum foil, cooking oil. Ano yung pastels that you recommend, Elmer?
Oil pastel, because
oil
the
pastel.
Medium has to be greasy, and also you also need to, for the original works, you use litho crayons, mm-hmm. litho pencils, mm-hmm. and a lithographic liquid, you know, called mm-hmm. touche.
Mm-hmm.
But for this type of alternative process, Emily Izier used soap. That you know, some also experimented with the ordinary butter.
Okay, shortening, mantika, you know, all those things. So it is doable to find just the right medium, something that is not water soluble but actually fatty, oily, mm-hmm. waxy, so that it will repel. The water washing when you remove it, but when you ink it, it comes back. The image comes back because you're using an oil based ink. Wow.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Mm. And also for kitchen lithography, what's this? I lost my thought. Sorry.
Mm. It's okay. It'll come back for sure. It'll come back. So
no, I remember. Don't be disheartened if you try this process, because for printing, the first, the second, and the third attempts are not really quite good, because when you the first printing is quite light, some are over ink, but then on the third and fourth fourth edition, it's already good. It's already good enough for an edition.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
For kitchen lithography, because the aluminum foil is so sensitive, it doesn't last. You can only print 20 editions.
20.
Yeah, but if there's also a tip that if you want to preserve the plate and then use it again in the future, you coat it with gum arabic. After you printed several editions, the one that used for watercolor, and then when you want to print again, you just rinse the gum arabic with water, and then
you're ready to ink
and print again.
Ah, I want a workshop with you, Elmer. No,
yeah. Sana we, mag-online. We'll do that. Oh, sana.
So, but we can, you know that we can through online social media. Okay, next slide, next question. Let's. This was a brief, a detour into your social practice, Elmer, because I also noticed that you were, do you collect prints and why? No. You posted that these were some of the prints that you have recently acquired for Pasilyo Press. Go ahead.
Yeah. I've also been collecting prints even before I went back to printmaking. You know, I had some prints by Orly Castillo, Papu de Asis, Honey Fernandez, a serigraph print, and by a Malaysian master printmaker who's a friend of mine, si Johari Sahid. And then the reason why I collect prints is I enjoy looking at it. And then when I look at the prints, I study the process, the way the artist did their markings and the way they inked it. And also at the same time, with other, collecting hobbies, it's the same thing as collecting vinyl record, old maps, books, because you're holding a piece of history.
Mm-hmm.
So collectors are just guardians, so other people can enjoy it in the next generation. So recently, I've been collecting some printmakers from the group Association of Pinoy Printmakers. So this one is a relief woodcut by Ambi Abano and Intaglio Dry Point by Benji Torado Cabrera, and an Intaglio Collagraph by Anton Villaruel, and the artist from Bohol, Gabi Nazareno, a relief woodcut. So
yes,
I'm really amazed with their prints. That's why I love to collect them, to keep them, and then look at them from time to time.
Yes. I agree. I also collect them, and it's very. I think you and I are going to try to find a way to store them properly, because we can't frame them all and hang them all. We run out of gallery space, on our walls.
Yes. So we always, as a maker to maker, it's also good to support other printmakers as well. And it's a small printmaking community, and you'll be surprised because most master printmakers are so very generous with their knowledge. No?
Mm-hmm.
So ito, yan ang mga advisors ko eh. When I want to ask some about materials, about techniques, yung mga sources, sila Ambi and si Idol Benji.
Yeah, that's nice about, spreading it, because they helped you. Now you're going to help others, diba? Spreading the printmaking love. So
yes. Here's
one. I also found that you were starting to frame and display your prints and print collection. So how did you do that?
Yeah, this is my realization, because when I started doing prints in the 90s, I read that it's usual practice, because the prints are limited edition. So it's advised, that you destroy the matrix, destroy the plate, or deface it, so you can't use it again, to produce an edition. So, nanghinayang ako kasi talagang yun ang ginawa ko. Yung mga iba, sinira ko talaga, tinapon ko. But I read somewhere that yung Victoria and Albert Museum in London owns a big collection of plates and matrix. So that is what I want to follow. And also, I think Edward Munch, The Norwegian printmaker also has a museum of his plates. So I came up with this idea. I think I saw it on Pinterest. When you put the print, you know, with the matting, you also include the matrix beside it. Then at the same time, you can also see the process. You know? So it's already preserved and it's under glass.
Similar to this, which is so nice to look at, especially with the small plates, no? I think Fundación Sansol and other institutions, like I learned yesterday from the talk from CCP and Ayala, that plates are also being preserved in the institutional collections because either they were donated or they're kept, you know, they were given. So it's still possible then to see plates because sometimes the plates can be fascinating to study. And especially with relief and woodcuts, like Ambi Abanyo's woodcuts are just amazing, you know, carved pieces. And so that is something also that you can look at, frame the plate, you know, and it's not ever going to be printed again.
That's correct. And also what other, to add to that, what other printmakers are also doing right now is when they finish doing their editions in rubber cut or in wood cut, they paint over it, they paint on the plate and then use the plate itself as an artwork.
Yes, yes. There's a few artists that do that, and they're in Palawan, Elordi Mesak. They're also exhibited in print fair, but it's exhibiting the works on paper, print muna. But maybe, you know, some relief rubber cut artists could be approached to see if, you know, their plates might also be available. So that's a good idea. Next slide. Let's go on. So, ito, the way you display it in your studio, you know, that's very nice to see. You're currently Pasilyo Press until you move to your new studio. And then I also noticed that, what is this? Do you carve to music, you know, Elmer? Do you make work?
Yes, I always, you know, paint and work with music because sometimes I follow the beat, no?
Oh, really?
Yeah. It makes your hand movements, you know, faster if you're listening to rock music, you know.
So it can actually inspire your process, no?
And because when you're listening to music while working, you get lost in time. No? Yeah.
The flow. It's called the flow. You're in the zone. You're in the zone. Next slide. We have you extended printmaking into your art practice in other ways? Just briefly, you know, you were still exhibiting throughout the year 2020, but I noticed that, you know, you did some shows, some exhibitions.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Most of the themes of my works are based on everyday life. You know? Some images are based on what I saw in films or read in books or in novels. But for social issues, if I want to, you know, make a stand, you know, like for the recent ones that are happening in the US, you know, the Asian hate, so I was moved seeing a CCTV video of a man assaulting an Asian woman. So I made a print and the Stop Asian Hate, and then the Asian Council in New York used this for their music video to promote the issue. And also we did a collaboration with Canvas Gallery, you know, with the Jigo Alampay. You have to choose some events in the Philippines. So on the upper left, it's called the Rizal Inhibia Park.
My favorite.
It's also, yeah, that's my biggest print so far. It's in rubber cut, the size is 3 feet by 3 feet.
Wow.
I was able to source a store in Marikina selling this size.
That's a lot of chinelas, no? Mm-mm.
So, right.
Next slide. Oh, you also have the 20 over 30 at the CCP portfolio.
Yes, I'm very honored to be part of the 2030 for the 50th anniversary of CCP in collaboration with AP.
And these are very different naman. They're not on paper necessarily. You've done something differently.
Yes, I printed on paper to use as gift wrapping and also for printed it on fabric. And then last year, I also tried my hand in the Japanese book binding.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the cover, I used the hand print using gold ink.
Yan. Very, very good. You're extending it into, you know, other applications or mediums or nice. It's very inspiring. Yes.
And I also made the print, put it inside a Tanduay rum bottle.
Your Desaparecidos series, di ba?
Yes. The Desaparecidos or the Disappeared.
Yep, it's you've been showing it on Instagram, a new series. This talks, or I can refer this back to Patrick Flores' talk about bringing printmaking into, you know, the contemporary, into the modern, beyond paper, beyond beyond maybe even the press, you know. So this is something to look forward to. Next slide. This is an example, another video. And something that I found super charming. Let's play the video. See, that is so lovely. It it's something you can do with either all your old prints that you maybe slightly imperfect, you can crop it, or you could even plan the project to make, you know, a series either with a story or a theme. So the book structure, the artist book structure, is very complementary to printmaking.
I also love to make artist books, and this one in particular is called an accordion book. It's from one piece of paper, and then you just fold it. And then I came upon the idea of putting it in a box because, you know, for me, I love to recycle. I don't want to throw away things, you know, as much as possible. So even for the misprints, You can save it, because I was thinking, what will I do with all these misprints? No, so I just, instead of throwing it away, I just cut them up and then made it into a collage. No,
yes,
transform it into another art form, and you can use different size of boxes. And then this one, I think it came from a box with from an art store supply with the water that they store it with watercolor tubes.
Yes.
So I use it. Yeah. Yes. And then I made a one print as a cover.
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. I think that's a print of Plet as a little girl, diba?
Yes, it's based from an old photograph when she was a little girl.
Yes. One more thing. I hope I'm not a senior moment, but it was like there was something that you said that was going to trigger it, but it's, you know, artist books and making it three-dimensional and using offcuts from old prints. Oh, yes. Now I remember. There's also, when you make editions, you can also do print exchanges. You can actually trade with other printmakers so that, you know, you can all collect the prints and then put them into a structure like a kind of portfolio, like our own type of 20 over 30 portfolio. So, you know, print exchange, print collaboration, that is now doing more of a, you know, community practice, no? So it's nice to have these different kinds of structures. So yeah, let's go on to the next.
That's also what I love about, you know, printmaking. There are so many endless possibilities with printmaking. And I hope we can also do another artist book exhibition. Because Ben Cab had done that before in the late 90s at the Loose Gallery. And then Mariano Ching also curated an artist book exhibition in Blank. So I hope we can also organize an artist book collection or exhibition of printmakers. But that's something to think about.
Elmer, I'll work with you on that if you want to. You know, let's keep that. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Let's look at your studio practice very quickly. No, this is a short term because Pasilyo Press, your studio for the future, near future, is being built and has been finished. No, so I noticed when I saw this picture, you are so neat. You are so tidy. I don't even want to show my studio because I'm all over the place. No. So, what are your favorite tools here? You have some carving.
Well,
tools.
this is my desk. I leave the center open for the papers and some other materials. So I have containers to put my pens, my measuring tools, and then on the side are fountain pens, some sketchbooks on the side, and some also small carving tools. And recently, I asked a friend to get me some burin for wood engraving. So that is also what I wanted to pursue. And then I asked a doctor, a friend of mine. That's an illuminated magnifier. Because when you work on a wood engraving, it's different from woodcut because you use the end grain of a wood, no, not like on woodcut, it's across the grain. So for woodcut, no, because it was so detailed, I had to use a magnifier.
Yeah, save your eyesight. You know, it's sharp tools and sharp eyesight. Next slide, and then. Pulling back, so when, what is the rest of the room?
So when I'm done with the, also in painting or other artworks, I normally made a lot of studies. So when I'm done with the studies and when I'm finished carving the plate, there's a designated print space on the corner of my studio where there's a workbench. And then my etching press and some artist proof on the wall so I can study. And then so I also organized my print tools on a pegboard. You know?
Yes.
So I hang my brayers and then there's a shelf for the inks. And then there are hooks, bull clip for the tube of inks.
Yes.
And then some brushes and palette knife. And then on the this corner, with the, this is made by a local printmaking professor from UP Diliman, is also, you know, in the future, he can also be a good resource person for printmaking. He teaches at the UP Diliman Fine Arts. His name is Ray Concepcion. So he makes his own brayers. So this one is a 6 inches brayer and 2 inches brayer. And it's so nice because the diameter is so big and it covers a lot of surface.
Yep. Oh, next slide. Elmer, we need to make time also for Q&A. No, they're starting to come in.
Yes.
So next, let's talk about Pasilyo Press. And you made a series of lovely prints about, you know, the building.
Yes. And we decided to make an extension of our studio specifically for printmaking. And my vision for Pasilyo Press is hopefully we can make other local artists to be interested to do prints, to go into prints.
So, we'll go to the next slide. That's something.
So
about...
this is my process. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So this is how the Pasilyo Press looks. No, there's the courtyard. On the left, on the white building, that's our studio or flatten. That's where I make my big works on canvas. And then this one with the cladding on the right side, that is the Pasilyo Press. That is where the workshop will be. And we're also a patron, a collector friend of mine, is also ordering for us a big etching press because that's always been a dream of mine to make big prints, big relief prints, and then to put it on the next level.
Yes, yes. And you are planning also to offer residency programs, you know, for local printmakers in the near future. And that is really, really going to be special.
Yes, and this Pasilyo Press is also a my model for this one is the one that Pandi Abiyado did when he arrived in 1978 from his trip from Europe. He made a monastery in Baguio, and then Romulo Olaso also had this 101 workshop in Quezon City where he did the edition prints for his artist friends.
Yes.
So hopefully
yes.
we can do that.
You have several inspiring, studios that have come before you. So I think this is about the last slide, next slide, and then we'll open it up to questions. Just briefly na lang, in closing, do you have a printmaking tip or advice for printmakers out there?
Yes. Siguro ano na lang, baka alam na rin ng mga ibang mga printmakers ito na we always have to think of our health. So for non-toxic materials, for cleaning your brayer, your ink tray and your plate, you use vegetable oil instead of paint thinner, turpentine or mineral spirit. Wherein you have to work on a well-ventilated room or you work outdoors. And then also, recently, I've also seen this with other printmakers, is when they carve using carving tools or when they use a stylus for dry points, especially if it's a bigger plate or it's very detailed. Ngayon, I'm wearing compression gloves. Kasi pag nung nag-post ako ng mga ibang mga process videos and then they see how they work, what material I use, and then some sculptor friends of mine kept reminding me na no, you have to be very careful because you might have a carpal tunnel or yung injury from repetitive movement of the wrist.
Tama.
No? So, tama. Yun. So, kailangan, you have to be aware and we have to, you know, take good care of ourselves and don't suffer for our art.
Ayan. That's very, very good tips. Just be aware physically that, you know, we need to watch it. Good health, good lungs, non-toxic, and then resting and, you know, taking a break from that repetitive. We have a lot of questions. My gosh. I'm going to start with what's been one of the first questions, you know, and I'll try to combine several. Do you have a wish list of tools that you want to try for, you know, other printmaking processes you're thinking of, you know, soon?
Wish list. Well, right now, I think I'm already complete with my tools already, you know.
Yeah.
Especially I just have to maximize them.
Yeah, you have to like parang put them through all the tests, especially with, you know, your facility now with relief and carving and even litho. All those that you have to use them up.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Well, one more thing with siguro yung I suddenly remembered yung wish list ko for dry point instead of using yung dry point diamond tools is the roulette to make textures.
Ah, tama. They are little metal wheels with a handle. And I think the best person to talk to siguro would be you know, Benji Torado Cabrera, because those are parang standard for marking on copper plates. You know, they make impressions on the soft copper. So he might be able to tell you more about those types of mark making tools. I have a few myself, but I've never really been, you know, able to try them yet. But it's true, the softer metal, no. Then for
there's some presses, I just want a larger bed plate
course.
I can accommodate bigger plates. That's my wish.
Yes. Then what? I think what other questions are, where can I buy non-acidic paper and other tools? We hope to put them all in a resource list, no? Mm-hmm. And so what we'll do, Elmer, is we'll send you some of these comments so that, you know, maybe you can share some of your sources, no? But know that imported tools and supplies, we need to find local substitutions. And that's where we printmakers can continue to experiment and test for local or, you know, available through Asia rather than, you know, U.S. That we're going to take care of those, answering those questions. There's one question, attempt to make a large mural-like print. And you did that with the Hibiya print of, how big was that? 3 feet by 3 feet, no?
3 feet by 3 feet. Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty large already as a mural, you know, for a print, because otherwise you would need, I don't know, steamroller press, you know, to run over a huge woodcut. Pwede yun, but you'll need a lot of help.
There's one technique for that, to make large mural print, you know, like what the South African artist did, si William Kentridge. Yung mga big prints niya are jigsaw puzzle prints, no? So it's several prints, no? That you paste together.
Yes.
So if you can't accommodate a bigger print, you know, just make several parang puzzle of prints and then you paste them up together.
Yes.
Yon, and then you can make a large mural.
Yes. Tama. Mm-hmm. So there are tips and techniques and tricks for that. It's just a planning process, you know, how much you can do with your press or with your pressure and then your paper, your plates, and then you'll need help inking. Dami. Malaki na yun. So,
oh, kailangan, you need assistance.
Oh, so time to do that with a printmaking community. I think shortly we might be running out of time. And if there are no more questions that I'm being fed, I'd like to think that this would be a good time to slow down a bit and hope that the rest of the fair and the rest of the panels, we still have several more through Sunday, that they're very interesting about groups, you know, doing art. And I will be hosting that tomorrow in the morning with PWU University, because they have a great printmaking initiative, and they'll start teaching workshops open to the public. And then in the after that, I will be sharing some experiences with working with printmaking groups in the Visayas, you know. Then on Saturday, we have a talk with Tinau Gallery and Henriel Pangkaliwangan. And again, the perspective of how does, you know, galleries respond to works on paper and prints, and that maybe Henriel and I could try to answer some of the questions that have come to us from, you know, collectors. So there are a few more, you know, panels coming up, but what I want to do right now is thank you so much, Elmer, for joining us today for this extended studio visit.
You're very welcome. And then lastly, I want to answer Mars Aglipay's question about whether I would like a printmaking tool or brand to be sold locally. I think one is the Feel tool, PFEIL.
It's
a Swiss brand, Swiss made for fine details for linocut and woodcut, and also the Akua brand of inks, AKUA, for intaglio. I think the art supply store should also have those materials available locally.
Elmer, we've been trying to communicate now with the, you know, several retail stores about that if there's this surge in printmaking interest, that they would have, you know, good, decent quality inks. But, you know, Akua is a non-toxic brand. And personally, you know, I use that in my studio. Mm. So maybe I can send you some small, because they have small testing, you know, units. And that might be something, because they've got a very strong pigment load and they're soy based. So, and it's water and soap washing, clean up, non-toxic. So I hope you, if I can send it to you, then you will see how much pigment, like rich pigment, but at the same time, transparency, so that you can, transparent layers. Very, very good. I highly recommend trying Akua, primarily for intaglio and for monotypes. It can be used for relief, but you'll just have to adjust. You'll just have to adjust to its properties.
Okay. Yeah, and so, also yung mga etching inks that are in tubes.
Yes.
Because right now, the one that is available is the gambling etching ink in cans. But, you know, sometimes pagka yung mga cans, they tend to dry up easily. So kung nasa tube, so better, but there's an advantage using inks in tubes.
Okay, I'm going to make a plug, huh? If the viewers will go and check out all our Facebook feeds, Fundacion Sanso, Cartolino, and the Association of Pinoy Printmakers, the oil paint store is offering has offered a 15% discount off of a specific printmaking list of inks. So there is Derivan Inks Black for Relief, and it's from Australia. It's quite crisp. And then they also have Gamblin etching inks and so on. So look for that 15% discount. So it's a chance to try some of those inks. And the promo code, PinoyPrint21, they are offering Marie's. It's an etching ink engraving color from China. And I have tried it okay, it's a plug, it's a promo, but I have to tell the truth that it worked for relief printing. And so, you know, it's a tube which won't let it dry out too much. It's oil-based, but the cleanup will be, again, oil on oil. Soften it up and then wipe it all off and then put a Dawn liquid detergent soap, grease fighter for the final cleanup. But it has six colors and the pigment load is strong and the it dries without too glossy. So, you know, I think I've shared it with, you know, some friends on Facebook, and check it out. Check it out at the oil paint store, you know, with a 15% discount. Okay. So I think, you know, we've been talking shop talk now, you know, and, yeah. and sharing so many tips. But
thank you, Angela.
I thank you again. And this has been a wonderful visit with you, Elmer. I hope to see you in real time, in real life, you know, when it's safe. And, you know, if you come to Negros, you know, come look me up. With Limbang Kamay Contemporary Print Fair signing off and thanking all the viewers for joining us this afternoon and keeping, you know, continue to enjoy, join us through the next few days through the end of the fair. And Elmer, again, all our gratitude for your support and for joining us. So with everybody,
you're very welcome.
I hope to say goodbye. Bye-bye. Then, and good night, and thank you.